Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast. If you're watching on YouTube, make sure to like, subscribe, and support our new movement by putting Let's Go Viral in the comment section. But if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice review. But without further ado, here are your hosts, Nicely Chunga Benny and Greg King.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Ball Fake Podcast, members of the Off the Ball Network. And today we're going to be discussing, you know, the Kyrie Irving situation, because earlier this week it was reported by Shams Charania and Adrian Wojnarowski that, you know, Kyrie Irving was going to be making a return back to the Brooklyn Nets in that organization. And he was going to be able to participate in the road games and be able to practice with the team once, you know, he comes back out of safety and health protocols. And, you know, I think there's a few benefits that, you know, Kyrie Irving brings to the table. Obviously, you know, Kevin Durant, James Harden, they've been carrying a lot of the offensive load if you're talking about the Brooklyn Nets just in general, right? And, you know, they're one of the better offensive teams in the entire NBA. A large part of that has to do with that duo. And, you know, essentially bringing in Kyrie Irving back, it gives you a lot more, you know, offensive firepower, you know, dating back to, you know, what they looked like last season when the big three was playing together. And essentially, you know, it also allows Harden and KD to have nights where they can rest, because they really haven't been able to benefit from that this season, especially KD. He's been playing a lot more minutes than normal compared to, you know, what he's done in years past and things of that nature. And Harden, he could definitely benefit from some extra time off due to the fact that, you know, he's fresh off a hamstring injury. And it doesn't really look like he's been able to rehab so much from that injury, you know, just based off what his performance has looked like, you know, this season. He isn't looking like the Harden that we're all accustomed to seeing. And, you know, essentially, you know, having Kyrie Irving play on road games, there may be some negatives, which I'm probably going to get into a little bit later on. But Greg, I want to get your thoughts on, you know, this situation just in general. What are your thoughts on, you know, Kyrie Irving coming back to the Brooklyn Nets, essentially?
It's crazy. I mean, I did not expect this. I mean, desperate times comes for desperate needs. And I think bringing Kyrie is great. I mean, I think it relieves the pressure, like you said, off of KD and Harden. KD's been playing a lot of minutes, like you said. And I think bringing a guy who has got a lot of offensive firepower, I mean, last year averaged 26, was a 50-40-90 guy. Just did a lot on the offensive end to take pressure off of Harden and KD. So I think bringing him back is great, and putting around the pieces. It's just the one concern for me is, like, how will Steve Nash, you know, implement the offense around Kyrie? I mean, I know he's been out for a long time, and how will he gel with the other players? Guys like Cam Thomas, Patty Mills, Joe Harris. I mean, all these guys around him, how will he gel with them coming back? So, and on top of that, and the big three, KD, Harden, and him. I mean, they didn't play a lot of games last year, so how will their chemistry be? So there's a lot of questions, but I think bringing them back was a positive. It was definitely a desperate need, and I think Kyrie will keep their heads above the water right now, and that's what they need. They're 21-9, first in the Eastern Conference, but I think bringing Kyrie back, teams can't just sleep on them. They're going to have to play some basketball against them, especially with Kyrie in the lineup. Nicely.
Yeah, absolutely. And essentially, I mean, bringing back Kyrie Irving, there are some positives. I don't think he resolves all of your issues, essentially, but I do have a few concerns, and it just starts out with the continuity, right? You talked about how, you know, KD and Harden and Kyrie Irving last year, you know, they didn't play a lot together. And, you know, that was a big root of, you know, their problems last season. You know, the lack of continuity, the lack of chemistry, not a whole lot of cohesion. And, you know, a part of that has to do with the fact that, you know, James Harden, they got him a little bit later on in the season. Well, a month into the season, he was signed, what, in January? But, you know, essentially, I think bringing back Kyrie Irving right now is essentially going to be a little bit of a disruption just in terms of the offensive flow and, you know, the overall flow of this team just in general. Like, he's never played with guys like Patty Mills, Cam Thomas, who more than likely isn't going to get a lot of minutes, especially with Kyrie Irving coming back for road games at least. But, you know, DeAndre Bembry, he also isn't really too familiar with his game. And if you want to bring up some of the bigs, Paul Millsap, James Johnson, I mean, those are some guys that he just doesn't have a lot of chemistry with, let alone any chemistry with, because he just hasn't been able to get on the floor at the same time as those guys as well. And I think, you know, with that being said, that could be a bigger issue than, you know, what we, you know, maybe giving it credit to. You know, obviously, I don't think that KD and Harden will have any trouble, you know, playing alongside Kyrie Irving. You know, I think those guys pretty much kind of have, you know, a pretty good chemistry built overall. I'm not too worried about them, but it's those role players, it's those new assets, those new acquisitions that you brought in, if you're Sean Marks, this past season, that, you know, it may be a little bit tough, you know, implementing Kyrie Irving back into the lineups. And not to mention, like you stated earlier, Steve Nash, second year head coach, you know, he's still trying to figure this thing out, right? You know, this is a guy that he's going to have trouble on those nights where, you know, you're going to have Kyrie Irving available. And now it's like, okay, I was relying on Cam Thomas and Patty Mills for, you know, all those home games. But now I have to implement Kyrie Irving back into the lineup. And, you know, the minutes distribution, it could, you know, kind of disrupt the flow of, you know, the Nets overall just in those terms. So those are really my biggest concerns with, you know, Kyrie coming back. Essentially, it's not, I don't think it'll be too much of a problem, but I don't think bringing back Kyrie Irving is essentially a home run hitter if you're the Brooklyn Nets.
Yeah, I totally agree. And the mention of Steve Nash thing, the minutes thing is exceptional, because you think about going on the road. I mean, yeah, he's going to be on the road. Now he's taking minutes for somebody else, like a Cam Thomas, Patty Mills. So it may be a Joe Harris when he comes back from an ankle injury. So you have to figure out how this team can really click on all these 22 games that he's playing in, because it's going to be tough. So they have to figure that out. And how are you going to use Kyrie? Is going to be mostly isolation? Are you going to do simple actions to get him involved in the offense? I mean, right now they're seventh in assists, so I like how they're moving the ball, and KD's actually averaging 6 assists, so he's bringing those assist numbers up and sharing the ball with his teammates and getting open looks. But how will Kyrie, who's mostly an isolation guard, how will that be with him coming back into the lineup? I'm very interested to see that nicely.
Well, the thing with Kyrie is, with him being an isolation guard, that actually takes a lot of pressure off of, you know, the scheming that Steve Nash is going to have to typically implement with him out of the lineup, right? You know, essentially, they kind of rolled the balls out last year, allowed KD, Harden to, you know, really do their own things from an offensive perspective. And defensively, you know, they didn't really have the personnel to really be competent. They were 22nd in the league from that standpoint last year. And, you know, once again, with guys like Patty Mills coming in, DeAndre Bembry, some of the better defensive, you know, guards in this league, When you mess with their minutes a little bit, when they're going to be in situations where, you know, they're going from nights where they're having 27 minutes per game to, you know, maybe 17 or 20, it may look a little bit eerie. But another thing that I want to bring up, and I haven't heard anybody talk about this, is Kyrie Irving. He's essentially going to be a free agent at the end of the 2023 season. That being said, if he's still under the status where he's unvaccinated, what position does that put the Brooklyn Nets front office in? Are you guys going to be 100% willing to, you know, re-sign this guy and just deal with the fact that, you know, he's not going to be available for, you know, 100% of your games? I mean, how is that going to, you know, affect this team just overall? I mean, that could be something that's extremely detrimental to what the Brooklyn Nets are going to be looking to do in terms of, you know, just winning games and being able to compete in the postseason and things of that nature. And I just don't know if they're going to be so willing to, you know, want to deal with that during the long term, especially given the fact that, you know, the whole reason why Kyrie Irving hasn't played to start the season is because he was unvaccinated and he wasn't going to be available for 100% of the games. So, I mean, I want to get your thoughts on that, Greg, just before we close it out.
Yeah, the rhythm. Yeah, I think the rhythm is a big word as far as this conversation, because how can, first of all, Kyrie catch rhythm, and how can the role players around him with Kyrie in the lineup catch rhythm if these guys are going, you know, they're playing 20 minutes this night and then 8 minutes another night. So, and then if you have him on the team till 2023 and they get to the playoffs, he can only play road games. So now when desperate times in the playoffs, you need to get, you know, you need to win big games and big series, you only have him on the road games, and you mess up the rhythm and the flow in a series if you keep going on and off with Kyrie. So they have to figure that out, and it's hard to trade him because he only wants to play in Brooklyn nicely. So they have some tough decisions to make going forward, but we'll just see what happens. But they need to figure that out. Someone needs to figure out, okay, Kyrie, are you going to get the vaccine or not? Because at this point, it's ridiculous, and it's really it's going to mess up in the long run.
And I wouldn't be necessarily surprised if they tried to maybe try to pressure him into possibly, you know, changing his status under, you know, the vaccination once again. But I mean, I don't know the likelihood of all that, but all I do know is that Kyrie Irving, he's going to be available to play. The Brooklyn Nets, you know, it made a lot of sense for them in the short term due to the fact that, you know, they're undermanned. But essentially, this could tend to, you know, blow up in their face in the long run. But let me know what you guys think about this situation in the comment section. Is Kyrie Irving going to be more of a positive than a negative? Or will this thing, you know, kind of crash and burn, essentially? But thank you guys so much for tuning in to another episode with me and Greg on the Ball Fake Podcast. If you're new to our YouTube channel or listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a 5-star rating and a nice little review. But besides that, it's your boy Nicey Chunga Benny. I'm here with my co-host Greg King, and we out.